Welcome once again to Riding in the Car with Pastor Bob. So, we're in downtown Nashville. I'd like you to take a little tour with me here. I'm just going to drive around and you can see Nashville as we talk. How does that sound? We're on First Avenue here. The Cumberland River is right beside me. Runs through downtown Nashville. There's a park there. There's a lot of places to go. And pretty fun place. A lot of people hang out here. And Nashville is definitely a tourist area. So this is the beginning of our tourist season. Just the beginning. We'll have to come back and take another drive down here when it's in full swing, because it gets quite interesting. So I want to talk about eternal security today, and this is a hot topic. In fact, I can't believe I'm going to open up this can of worms, but I think it's kind of important, and I have a little bit of time to talk about it. But instead of really focusing on just eternal security, I want to talk about sin, because I think that's the foundation of where we find our differences and how some people just get real frustrated with this whole topic. When you tell people that you're secure in your faith, that Jesus Christ died on the cross for your sin and paid the price for it and removed it as far as the east is from the west, never to be found again, the next thing that a lot of people say is, well, aren't you afraid to tell people that? That isn't that like saying you just go ahead and sin as much as you want to and you'll still be saved? And the answer to that is, well, yes. But is that really what happens? And is that really the foundation? Is that really what I need to be worried about? You know, here's the bottom line. By the way, if you look across there, there's our stadium. That's where the Titans play, right across the river there. Kind of cool. And we'll just go up Broadway here, which is a real interesting street. Anyway, so when you say that, people think, well, you shouldn't tell people that because then they'll just want to sin. You have to tell them instead that, you know, you have to be careful because when you sin, you go to hell, and so don't sin. Well, then what did Jesus do on the cross? And is it a scary thing to tell people that their sin is forgiven? Even the ones that they haven't committed yet. Wow, that's a big one, isn't it? Well, you see, here's the bottom line, folks. Our freedom is from the bondage of sin. And once you're concentrated on sin all the time, you're in bondage to it. Christ said, I want to lift the bondage of sin. You're free not to sin now. Had you thought about that before? You're free not to sin now. You know, I've talked about this before, and it's like that pink elephant in the room, you know. People don't talk about it, but if you say, don't look at that pink elephant, all you can do is look at him because your focus is there, you know. And the more you say, I'm not going to look, I'm not going to look, the more you look. And the same thing is true with sin. The more you say, I'm not going to sin, I'm not going to sin, the more you sin. And Christ said, you know, I know that that's what you do. I know that's your problem. I know that what you need is something that transcends your bondage to sin. And that basically is Christ's death on the cross and his release for you from the bondage of sin. There's Chuck, the guy with the guitar, one of the street musicians that eats with us, walking up the street. I know most of these homeless people here, they all eat with us. The crowds are light on the streets today. If you see this during the weekend, or during the tourist season especially, you can't hardly drive or walk here. So welcome to Nashville during the week. Anyway, so now I have been I've been bought with a price. My sins have been nailed to the cross, and I'm free not to sin. Well, why can I say that, and why is it important that I'm free not to sin? Because, folks, I have an opportunity now to allow Jesus Christ to be the ruler of my life, not to let sin stand in the way, but to see another way. I am not in bondage to this sin and death thing that I was on before, but now I am free in Christ. And something happens when I willfully sin at this point. I don't feel very good about it. I don't enjoy it very much. And I feel that it cuts in on my relationship with God. And so it's not really something that I want to pursue. But it's my decision now. And folks, I have to tell you that the closer that I get to the Lord, the more I decide not to sin. I decide not to, because I don't want to. And I sin less and less because I'm not in bondage to it anymore. That bondage was nailed to the cross. That's a really good place to be, isn't it? The bondage was nailed to the cross. So now I can walk in victory. I can walk in peace. And I know that no matter what, that God loves me, that He died for me, that He absolutely set me free. We'll let this guy go first here. Oh, good. Justin Bieber's going to be here June 27th. That's pretty exciting. So, Christ paid for my salvation. He paid for my eternity. He said when you become a Christian, you pass from death onto life. Why? Because He gave us life. He took away the bondage of my old life and gave me a new one. He took away the bondage of sin and death and gave me a new place to be, a new place to stand, a new relationship with God. And now I'm at a point where I sin less. My desire to sin is not where it used to be at all. And every year I find that it's getting less and less. That's the point. So folks, we can't do it. You know, when we try to discipline ourselves to be a good Christian, by the way, there are no good Christians, but when we discipline ourselves to be a good Christian, we fail every time. Why? Because we can't do it. And at that point in time, 2,000 years ago, Christ said, you know, I know you can't do it. I realize that. And I'm taking your place. I'm going to die on the cross. I'm going to make it possible now for you to have a relationship with God for eternity, not based on your discipline, because you suck at that, but based on your surrender to me. And then He said, and I'm going to give you a bonus. I'm sending the Holy Spirit, and He will guide you into all truth. He will continue to set you free, and He will continue to be the very thing in life that will keep you from sin. So we have the whole package. And should we be afraid that if we tell people that Christ died for our sin, that they're just going to want to sin more because now they're forgiven? No, that's not the point. The point is, yep, you can do whatever you want to do now. But the question is, what do you want to do now? What do you want to do now? You see, my desires have changed. And when you begin a relationship, and our relationship with God is the same way, when you begin a relationship, you don't start by saying, you know, I need you to be in bondage to this relationship, and I need you to work really hard and really disciplined to be perfect. Or do you say, I want our relationship to be based on love? And I'm going to give you freedom in this relationship, and I'm going to love you unconditionally. And I hope that because of that love, that every single day you will grow in that love and you will sin against me less. You see, that's how any relationship works, and that's how our relationship with God works as well. So it isn't about my performance. It isn't even about my ability to discipline myself enough to stay on the straight and narrow. And again, I'm not saying that discipline is a bad thing. But what I am saying is, make sure, folks, make sure that you're not in bondage to sin anymore. You know, the Bible says that Christ's load is light. His burden is light. You don't have to carry a burden any longer. Well, on the right-hand side, you see this huge building, and this is Music City Center. A lot of concerts go on there. On the left, you see Bridgestone Arena, where lots of concerts are going on there, too. You know, they'll have everybody from, well, Justin Bieber coming to, Megadeth was there, Metallica was there, Iron Maiden was there, you know, some great bands. So there's a little bit of every kind of music here in Nashville as well. Some of the best little jazz and blues clubs are here too. And of course, we do have country music. Up on your right here, this is the Country Music Hall of Fame, the Country Music Museum. And all things country are right there. If you look on the left-hand side up here, you'll see the Nashville Symphony. And again, a whole lot of building going on. Any night of the week in Nashville, there's at least 300 concerts. And those range from, you know, live music in a little bar to a big arena with a lot of music. So a little bit of everything, and Nashville is absolutely Music City. If you've never visited it before, you ought to. You'd enjoy it. It's really something to see. Well, folks, it's been good to hang out with you today, and we'll join you next time. Join me next time when we have Writing in a Car with Pastor Bob. God bless you.